When you're born in this world, you're given a ticket to the freak show.
It's reminiscent of those pictures we've all seen too much on television before, when a building was deliberately destroyed by well-placed dynamite to knock it down.
And when you're born in America, you're given a front row seat.
So part of it is we have to break through our kind of private idea that kids belong to their parents.
Forget the politicians. The politicians are put there to give you the idea that you have freedom of choice. You don't.
There is no America. There is no democracy.
You have no choice. You have owners. They own you.
There is only IBM and ITT and AT&T and DuPont, Dow, Union Carbide, and Exxon. Those are the nations of the world today.
It's a big club, and you ain't in it.
You know how naive you sound.
Why?
Senators and presidents don't have men killed.
Oh. Who's being naive, Kay?
They got you by the balls.
Night of the fight, you may feel a slight sting. That's pride fucking with you. Fuck pride. Pride only hurts. It never helps. You fight through that shit. Because a year from now, when you're kicking it in the Caribbean, you're gonna say to yourself, Marcellus Wallace was right.
What up, freaks? How we doing? Hello, hello, hello. Hello and welcome to the front row at the Freak Show. I am your most humbled host, Crafty, here. And I'm ready. I am ready to help guide you all over the next couple hours that we are together through this thing that we do call the Freak Show. Basically those things that we want to talk about that they don't want us talking about. Exposing the things they don't want exposed, and generally shining a light on those darkened doorsteps of society. Of course, we want nothing more than to also have a good time as well. And as always, we'll mix the things up with a few laughs and also get our groove on with a tune, making us what I believe to be the only variety podcast out there that I know of anyway. And where else are you going to catch up on the news and events of the day, and actually delivered with that little thing that we like to call the truth? But where else are you going to get that? With some stand-up comedy, some kick-ass music, huh? No way, mon frere. Yeah, that was stealing from the legendary George Carlin. Where is the hair on a chocolate eclair? Nowhere, mon frere. But anyway, no, I do thank you for tuning into us tonight. If you are listening to us live, then you have, in fact, realized we are now streaming right from frontrowatthefreakshow.com, and we are able to do this through the good freaks over at Ustream. You can, I suppose, check us out there as well, but not sure why the heck you'd want to do that. Actually, though, if you do want to check us out on the fly, like your mobile device, Ustream then is the way to go. Download their app, and I'm not exactly sure how it works, but you just punch in Front Row at the Freak Show, and I'm pretty sure we're going to pop up. And a process that literally takes seconds. So, anyway, as always, I am coming to you live from FEMA Region 1 and also in the general vicinity in the same region is one of my partners in crime, the Atomizer. And we will be bringing him aboard in just a moment. And also, of course, the Baxman will be checking in, but not with his usual backstage pass this week, unfortunately. At least I don't think so. Bax is actually vacationing, so we are going to get a check-in from him, from the road, as it were. But let's see. If you are on the website and you want to call in and join the conversation tonight, obviously we would love to have you and love to hear from you. We highly encourage it. So you'll see the number up there on the screen. And there's also, once you dial that, you have to dial the access code to get in. So it should be all right there. And I don't have it written down in front of me, actually. But 855-355-4128, 4218. Atomizer could correct me. I actually don't have the site because I didn't want to stream it in front of me. And let's see, then the access code is 373-2566 or Freak On. And other than that, to finish up our business here, you, of course, can also find Front Row at the Freak Show on Facebook and YouTube. Tweet heads can get us at the Freak Show, at Front Row Bax, and at Atomizer1. I'm sure I've mentioned it before, but y'all definitely need to go ahead and follow Atomizer as on if you're a tweet hound, because he does get some good tweet battles going. And all right, Bax is also on Facebook with Bax Baxton. You can check him out there. And finally, Crafty at frontrowatthefreakshow.com to hit us up via email, and frontrowbax@gmail.com. Holy shit. that's a pick your poison right there of ways to get in touch with us. So, all right, let's not fuck about any longer. Let's get right to the action tonight, because once again, we have another jam-packed show ahead. And with if you used to following us on Blog Talk Radio, then you know the show was 2 hours. We might eventually push it to 3 hours. I think tonight, though, we're going to shoot for 2.5. So we will go till about 11 o'clock tonight. And I did want to, the main topic of the show tonight is really an extension from last week, the drought in California, but more specifically, right where we left off, which was weather modification. However, before we get there, I do want to hit on a few current events before getting to that. And so why don't we do that? Let's go. I see we have Atomizer here. I just need to unmute the man, so let's do that. Atomizer, my friend, you got your ears on.
I'm here, brother. How's things going?
Fantastic. And you know what? Just your first couple of words there, I am checking the audio levels very attentively, and it seems like it was coming in pretty good. So I'm sure all the freaks out there are hearing you loud and clear.
Excellent.
Yes. How we doing, my mountain man?
Oh, busy day, but otherwise I'm in good shape. Happy to be here as always. Been brushing up on some of the materials for tonight.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, ready to rock and roll.
Excellent, excellent.
How about you?
I'm doing all right. Yeah, you know, it's weird with the switch. You know, I had you know, not that we've been doing it forever, but I certainly was in a you know, Blog Talk Radio kind of groove, having to do X amount of things prior to the show, and so now I'm in a different groove. And, of course, the thing is, I never know if it's working out there, right? I can't really check it out, you know, while we're going. So I did want to mention, Atomizer, and you might be interested in this. Oh, I actually forgot to bring it up. Well, here's test number one. So for those watching, I'm now able to kind of change video screens, right? Put up a new screen, so... you know, for instance, and we should still be hitting the audio here, but, you know, now we got our contact info up, in front of us. And, yep, so that's all good. So, yeah, just, you know, like I said, kind of still obviously very much getting used to the new procedures here.
Right.
On frontrowatthefreakshow.com/Ustream. But so far, so good. I also have to keep an eye, I guess, on my CPU usage, because I think that is what is the culprit if we were to get disconnected from the stream. So, that's it. Nothing that anybody else really needs to know.
Well, hey, we're stretching our legs in our new home, and, you know, again, we did, for those of you who didn't catch us on Wednesday, of course, we did a little test show, which was a lot of fun. I had to duck out a little early. I was kind of sad about that, but it had to happen. And, you know, again, I think we're enjoying this new format, and I think we're enjoying this new platform. Hopefully this is going to work a lot better, not just for us, but for everybody out there listening. So let's check it out together, and, hey, if you got complaints, you know how to reach us.
Yeah, I just gave about 37 ways to do that. So,
we are not inaccessible.
we have to extend the show to 3 hours just to get all the contact info out there. But no, and I'm sure that you know, the regular listeners will probably notice probably the biggest difference for them will be something that they might not have been aware was going on, and that was the delay between you and I and or Bax talking. And right now, for instance, Atomizer and I have a, you know, pretty instantaneous conversation going, which should eliminate any, you know, speak overs that we occasionally ran into with you know, on Blog Talk. So that's a big one, and it's a great one. So you know, just being able to have this non-delayed conversation with you makes me happy to no end, Atomizer.
Yeah, I think, you know, timing is important in this type of thing. And it's, you know, for those of you who were paying close attention, you might have noticed certain points where one of us would finish saying something and then we'd have to kind of wait for that to for it to catch up on the other person's end before they jumped in and everything. You know, it's really ugly when you have that little delay, you know, even if it's just a second. It just really throws everything off. So this is much better. You know, we can do a good back and forth. We won't be stepping on each other. You know, we won't have that, you know, couple seconds of dead air while we're waiting for somebody to respond. I think this will work out a lot better for us.
Yes, yes, yes. And, as I said, I was giving out the phone number, but then I didn't have it in front of me. Can you just give that out? 855-355, is it 4128?
4218.
4218.
855-355-4218 with the access code FREAKON.
Yes. Fantastic. All right, Atomizer. Enough with the chit-chat, huh? Obviously, as I had already mentioned, main topic for tonight, which we'll get to in a little bit, you know, a little continuation of the drought in California, or more specifically, the weather modification, geoengineering. But I did want to pick up a few things or touch on a few things that I think are fresh, very relevant going on right now, and on the bigger side of things, maybe get your thoughts on them. I know I'm kind of catching you last minute with these thoughts, but I think it's important to bring these up anyway. The first of which is the G7. What do you call it? Conference meeting, which is going on in, Austria, I believe. But you talk about your freak shows in action. I don't know if anyone's caught any videos yet. And I will point out to the good people over there at We Are Change. Luke Radowski has his boots on the ground over there and uploading a lot of videos. And he, you know, pretty good reporter. But catching already what is a lot of crazy action going on over there. He had in one of his videos reported that there are 38,000 cops that have been hired or put on duty just for security around the G7, which is well more than one per expected protester.
38,000 cops is like a fucking nightmare. I mean,
yeah.
It just makes me want to wake up screaming. I didn't even know there were 38,000 cops.
Right. Right. Especially in Austria. You know, and
yeah, that's true. It's Austrian cops, so they all sound like Arnold Schwarzenegger.
Right. And they all look like, and that was my next point. They all look like him too. Yeah. They all look like him too. Because of course it's not just 38, you know, Andy Griffins over there. You know, I mean, this is 38,000 decked to the nines in military equipment, riot gear, tear gas, pepper spray, machine guns, MRAPs, water hoses.
Drive past me today.
What's that?
I saw an MRAP drive past me today.
Did you really?
Yeah, in fucking backwoods New Hampshire, of all places.
Now, they need one up there.
Yeah, yeah. I thought last I had heard Concord tried to get one because, and they cited as their reasoning that they're dealing with terrorist groups, specifically naming the Free Staters and, you know, my old association there, you know, the Anonymous Group. I don't understand in either case how they did it. In fact, I believe the Free Staters either sued them or threatened to sue them, and they had to retract it. But yeah, I know Concord tried to get one. I don't know where this one was from. I didn't catch the logo on the side. But yeah, driving down through the area about Weir's Beach, happened to cross a big old MRAP driving right past me, and you know, heading the other direction. I'm like, okay.
Yeah. The ultimate peacekeeper. But, well, you know, it just goes, you know, it segues nicely into, real briefly, what I wanted to hit on about the G7, right? And what I'm wondering, right, and this, I guess, goes for any protest, really, is, you know, what are these cops thinking, like, when they go home at night, you know? I mean, for the most part, you know, even cops that make a decent wage, they're still working people, you know. They're not by any means close, even on anything resembling the same scale as the men that they're, you know, quote unquote protecting. And you know, like one of the videos put up by We Are Change, they're literally in a tug of war with the protesters over the sign that the protesters had, right? And they like had to get the sign away from the protesters, you know? And it's like, is it really that important? Like, I just, you know, I'm baffled that there's 38,000 people just willing to fall in line. And it's like, yeah, okay, I understand, you know, shit gets crazy, whatever. But, you know, mass pepper spraying, you know, mass tear gassing these people that all they want to do is protest some what they think are injustices and, you know, obviously not that they're in the United States, but, you know, exercise their freedom of speech and, that's it. You know
I'll say this, because I grew up with a friend of mine who was in a all-cop family, and you know what I'm talking about. You know, his father's a cop, his uncle's a cop, his grandfather was a cop, blah, blah, blah. He gave me some great advice. He sat me down one day, he said, you know what, when it comes to cops, he says, there's three kinds of cops. He says, obviously there is the guy who got pushed around in high school, and now he has a badge and a gun and something to prove, and these are the cops you want to stay away from. He's like, and sadly, that may actually be the majority of cops, especially in cities and places like that. He says, and then you got the cop who's just doing it because it's a job. You know, he maybe served in the service. It's a good job for him to get with a good pension and everything else, you know. And he's the guy that's not going to bust you unless you give him a reason to, you know. He walks past you smoking a joint. He's not really going to look twice unless you fucking flick the joint at him, you know what I mean? And then there's the third one, which is the by-the-book cop, which is the guy who, you know, does everything by the book. No better, no worse, is never going to, you know, he's not a bad guy because he's never going to crack your skull or anything like that because that's not by the book. But, you know, if you're smoking a joint, he'll absolutely haul you in and that's the end of it. And, you know, ever since he told me that, I've sort of looked at cops in a very different way, and I think it's very helpful to sort of think of it in those terms and those three types of cops out there. You know, try to assess.
Right. Try to quickly assess.
Cop, especially in an unpleasant situation. Yeah. Try to figure out which of those three things you are. And you know what? If it's the guy who got picked on in high school, who has a badge and a gun and something to prove, just fucking run.
Right. Well, and it's funny, that's the guy you kind of highlighted there, because I'm just wondering, and maybe this is the guy that, I don't think so, though, because I think there's a fourth category. And it's just that, you know, probably ex-military, right? And just needs to have a gun on him, and you know, uber aggressive.
I
don't know if he falls in that first category, you know, or not.
Trace him back to high school. These are the guys that, again, whether they got picked on in high school or whether they got picked on in grade school, then had a growth spurt, and were the ones picking on people in fucking high school. I think it's the same thing. I still think we're talking category one.
Yeah. Yeah, very well. Just the uber aggressive. Right, over the top, just wants to shoot something or someone. And it's probably, let's point out and be clear, that's probably the minority of cops, but unfortunately, it doesn't take many of those to change a situation, right? You know, if you have 38,000 cops here at the G7, it only takes three of them. You know, or let's say four for 10% or 1%, and you got yourself a pretty dangerous and, you know, incendiary situation.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Well, I mean, you know, you take the Ferguson protests, and, you know, I was listening to a guy who actually had some training in crowd control who was saying, you know what you don't do is you don't show up with fucking combat gear, guns, and everything else and have a fucking standoff. You know, what you do is you show up with a bunch of bottles of water. You hand them out, you fucking talk to the people, you tell them you understand what they're going through. You know, you diffuse the situation. And that's the, I think when you've got 38,000 cops gathered of all different types of cops and everything else, I don't see a lot of people rushing to diffuse situations versus escalating them. So
yeah,
good luck if you're over there.
Yeah, no, absolutely. And like I said, you could, obviously, there's plenty of people showing footage, but I'd like to point out We Are Change. Luke Radowski, pretty much the main guy, or the only guy, or the guy that started it all, doing his usual great work on the ground over there. And I'm a fan of Luke's and his work. And last note for me on that, I guess, for those 38,000 cops, and, you know, this is just lasting a few days, so it's costing the taxpayers over there 600 million euros just for security. I'm sure they're very happy about that as well.
Right.
So...
Yeah, and the problem, it'd be one thing if it was the problem I have is all of that, or the vast majority of that, just as it would be over here, is being put on the working taxpayer, not on the guy who's just sitting around making his money make money. In fact, when we get to it, I got a fun little, for those of you who haven't caught it already, Warren Buffett was in the news recently spewing some very funny shit.
Nice. Well, do you want to go with that? It might lead in nicely to actually the second little tidbit I wanted to bring up, because I'm sure if he is not this week, then, you know, he certainly has been in the past, you know, a part of what I'm going to bring up. But do you want to go with that now, or do you want to wait on that?
Sure. Sure, I'll toss that out there now.
Sure.
Now, I just want to preface this by reminding people, Warren Buffett is a piece of shit, okay? Do not believe that just because he comes out once in a while and says things, you know, and is a little more honest than some of the other rich pieces of shit out there, that he's any better than they are. You know, yes, he'll come out and tell you that his maid pays less, pays more of a percentage in her taxes than he does. But yet he fights, you know, he uses his money to fight to make sure that that not only stays the case but gets worse. The man disowned his granddaughter for appearing in a movie where she commented on how the wealth system is skewed, and it's really not fair that working people are scraping to get by while non-working elites are not. But anyway, this was from a couple of weeks ago, and I apologize for the delay because, you know, I live in the mountains. Sometimes it takes a little while for news to reach me, but it gets there eventually. But yeah, it was a couple of weeks ago. Warren Buffett comes out, and I don't remember exactly where he was. It was an interview with, I don't know. It doesn't matter where he was when he said it, but this is the quote, and this is the important thing. Warren Buffett's own words, quote, "No conspiracy lies behind this depressing fact. The poor are most definitely not poor because the rich are rich." He says, "Nor are the rich undeserving. Most of them have contributed brilliant innovations or managerial expertise to America's well-being. We all live far better because of Henry Ford, Steve Jobs, Sam Walton, and the like. Instead, this widening gap is an inevitable consequence of an advanced market-based economy." Wrap your fucking heads around that for a minute. Wrap
the time has come for someone to put his foot
first
down.
Of all, he's full of shit. The poor
and that
absolutely
foot
poor
is me.
Conspiracy.
Worse. Okay, that's what the wealth gap is all about. Second of all, okay, Henry Ford, Steve Jobs, Sam Walton. Why do rich people, first of all, want to pretend that these fucking people created what they created in a vacuum without help from anybody else, and that what they created was so significant that they should be rewarded with things like these $71.3 billion that Warren Buffett's worth? By the way, what was his innovation again? Oh, yeah, that's right, nothing. But I mean, you know, take the three names that he throws out there. Henry Ford, Steve Jobs, Sam Walton. Guess what? All dead. Okay? You know who's enjoying their wealth, for the innovations that they supposedly created all by themselves without the help of hundreds of other fucking supporting people that got nothing or next to nothing or barely a fucking decent salary for it? Guess what? It's their children. It's their fucking children's children. Right? It's the Walton family. It's the Ford family. It's fucking whoever Jobs left his money to. All right?
Mm-hmm.
What innovations did they come up with again to contribute to society? You know, why do we not have a fucking massive inheritance tax? Why do we not, you know, why are we allowing people, you know, I mean, even if you're going to subscribe to this theory that it's better to reward people like, you know, Ford, Jobs, or Walton with fucking $70 billion instead of just, you know, giving them an hour on TV and $1 million was the suggestion of Richard Wolff, which I think was excellent. You know, $1 million is a lot of money. That's fucking plenty. You know what I mean? And then give some to the other people that helped them out, and then give the rest to society. But again, even if you believe that they deserve that they created this in a vacuum, everything else, what did their fucking kids create? What did Warren Buffett himself fucking contribute?
Yeah.
Okay, all he did was, you know, he's the Oracle of Omaha. He fucking bought low and he sold high. Where's the innovation in that? So, you know, you read shit like this, and I'm sorry, it just makes me want to fucking puke. This is the kind of stuff that right-wing America is eating for breakfast, literally, when they turn on Fox News. And it's fucking ruining this country. This idea that this is the way things should be, that the rich deserve to live as kings among men with $71.3 billion because of their massive contributions to society that they did by themselves. And, oh, by the way, who cares that it's their fucking, that money all belongs to their kids now? And was, you know, virtually untaxed as inheritance. You know, who cares? How fucking democratic is it that these people, these individuals, get to throw around this kind of money to affect all of us? You know what I mean? When Warren Buffett goes and spends however many billions he's going to spend, or the Koch brothers spend fucking $900 million trying to hijack the next presidential election, how democratic is that? How fucking, you know... I'm sorry, this is ridiculous bullshit. We need to fucking get on top of this. We need to stop believing whatever the rich tell us and stop believing that they deserve their lifestyle. While you've got over 60,000 people worldwide starving to death every year, at least dying due to hunger-related causes, when you've got one in three children in America...
I think that's every day.
Yeah.
You said every year, yeah. I think. Every day, 60,000.
Well, I mean, regardless, the simple fact that there are people who don't know where their next meal is coming from, and yet Warren Buffett's walking around with $71.3 billion saying, oh, we earned this, and it's not our fault the poor are poor. Fuck you, man. Fuck you.
I completely agree with you, and I'm glad you mentioned that quote and brought it up, because it is going to work brilliantly here into this second little nugget that I wanted to touch on. But let's just take a quick minute break here, Atomizer, and then when we come back, I will lay that on you. So be back in 1 minute. Conspiracy?
Yeah, I mean, the fact is you've got these psychopaths, whether they're running the top businesses or whether they're running the country or both, that, they want more and more and more. That's all they can think about, and they'll step on anybody and send your kids off to die to get it. And that's the world we live in.
My mother was actually a black Irish Italian Muslim, lesbian hooker with a lisp.
Maybe.
What is so interesting about us in the first place?
This fucking soulless horse.
My question is to the Atomizer.
I'm glad you asked, Atomizer.
Then you really need to re-examine your objectivity on the subject, because you don't have any.
Screwed?
My ass is open. Wait, let me rephrase that.
Read that book, cover to cover, read that fucking book.
I'm not sitting here suggesting we burn them all and completely rid the planet of them.
And if the God described in the Bible is real, and is what is described in that Bible, he's not your fucking friend. He's a monster, and we should all get together and hunt him down and kill him.
Definitely.
To me, at the very least, it's the root of all tyranny.
Get your freak on. Front row at the Freak Show, blogtalkradio.com/frontrow. And we're back. All right, so... like I was saying, Atomizer, I think that works in perfectly, because alongside the G7 this week is also the beginning of Bilderberg, the Bilderberg Conference, which is in pretty much right in the same area anyway. And maybe I got it mixed up, because they are in the Austrian mountains near Telfs. But anyway, the Bilderberg Conference, and that's according to InfoWars' Paul Watson, and that was according to local police. They verified that the conference is taking place at the opulent Interalpen Hotel. So in a press release, the Austrian police revealed that security for the confab will be in operation from June 9th to the 14th, as is usually the custom with Bilderberg. The actual meeting of delegates will take place from the Thursday to the Sunday of this week, June 11th through the 14th. I don't know what your thoughts are, Atomizer, on Bilderberg.
Well, I will just say my first thought is I got to wonder what they get for swag at those kind of conferences.
What's
you know
that?
What I mean? You always go to a conference and you get fucking, swag, stuff we all get.
Yeah,
stuff. Can you imagine what the fucking freebies are like? I mean, it's probably a giant fucking boat basket full of cars, man. Lexuses and Ferraris and shit. I mean, what the hell? I can only imagine.
I'm thinking of that scene in Godfather 2 when they're all sitting around the table passing around that solid gold telephone. Probably worth, a couple million dollars, whatever, But, yeah, like, that's the party gift, right?
I mean, back in my career, I went to a lot of conferences. I got a lot of nice swag, but I can only fucking imagine what the hell, you know, what you walk in and get when you, you know, I mean, did they just hand you a fucking land grant for 50 million acres or
yeah,
some
yeah.
shit?
Maybe there's just the slave waiting there for you, you know, like just some guy yeah. tied up to the...
yeah, exactly. Might as well, you know. But no, I'm certainly familiar with the Bilderberg thing. I think, honestly, I find it... The only thing I find surprising is that people are surprised when they find out that the top power and money players in the world occasionally get together behind closed doors to plot ways to fuck over the rest of us. I mean, I would think that that would be expected. I'm just honestly surprised that they aren't doing it a little bit more secretively, that this is as known as it is. You know, nothing good is happening in these fucking meetings, I promise you that. But yeah, it's, you know, again, what do we expect? We've got a bunch of fucking plutocratic, oligarchical fucking fanatic psychopaths out there that are, you know, basically sitting there dividing up the world and figuring out what the next scam's going to be, you know?
Yeah, yeah. And, you know, of course, I don't know the level of knowledge of the listeners as far as, you know, is Bilderberg. Is just hearing that name like, huh, what? Or, you know, is there some level of knowledge? I'm sure, you know, for the most part, people listening and tuning into the show have an idea and have heard what, you know, at least the basics of Bilderberg. But there might be a couple people out there that have not heard of it before. And for those people, I think it's worth mentioning that Bilderberg is the name of this group and this conference. It happens once a year, and it's about 100 of the top, to say 1% is probably a gross understatement. It is probably more like the top 0.00001%. And it's a rotating list. I think there's a few regulars every single year, but for the most part, it is a bit of a rotating list. For instance, you might have it's come out. It's certainly come out now over the years, and the more and more that we're learning about it, you know. For instance, the year that there's going to be a United States presidential election, somehow, you know, one or two of the candidates always finds his way invited to Bilderberg, and usually that person coincidentally is then the president of the United States. It started back in 1954, and the first conference was held by Prince Bernhard of the Netherlands. And it was hosted at the Bilderberg Hotel, so that is where they get their name. And, I'm almost afraid a little bit of going down this path that, you know, I just wanted to brush up and do a little research on Bilderberg myself. But I'm a little afraid to kind of go down this road, but it very much, obviously, Atomizer plays into, you know, what you were talking about with Warren Buffett and his quote. But, you know, I started looking into Prince Bernhard, and holy shit, I mean, there's just all sorts of stuff out there about this guy, you know, his ties to the Nazis and IG Farben. But, I actually ended up stumbling upon the writing of Eustace Mullins. Are you familiar with Eustace Mullins?
I don't think I am. I think I would remember that name.
Hmm. Eustace was actually the G. Edward Griffin before there was G. Edward Griffin. And I guess that's to say Eustace, way before Griffin put out Creature from Jekyll Island, Eustace had all but put down the truth about the Federal Reserve, you know, its secretive, covert beginnings. He collected a lot of that information originally. And again, don't want to go too far down the rabbit hole here, but I've heard bits and pieces from Eustace over the years, and I think he's been on Alex Jones a couple times. And I'm going from memory right now myself, but I'm pretty sure that he was hired by Ezra Pound, a man whose story is definitely freak show worthy himself. You know, he was a poet, and he ended up being, you know, imprisoned by the United States government in Washington for a period of time. And it's actually during the time he was put in prison that he hired Mullins to get the skinny on the Federal Reserve, and that's what he did. So he also then ripped into all of the elites of the time, like Rockefeller, the Morgans, the Warburgs, and all of them. And Eustace does not pull any punches, right? I mean, he rips, for example, Rockefeller, and basically lays out all the evidence on how he, you know, started the AMA and forced out any and all homeopathic or alt medicine, and created the fuck show that we know and hate today, and same with education. You know, so he really gets at that elite power structure, especially its beginnings at the turn of the last century, and you know, those guys that created the Buffetts and the, you know, just like, you know, you're talking about all those guys who had died. Well, this is the group that he really went after, right? And just how they absolutely came in, you know, made their millions and billions mostly illegally, and then wrote all the laws so that, right, their families could just keep it going and gain greater control and more power as the years unfolded.
Right.
You know?
Yep.
And...
Yep, no, you know, I'm certainly familiar with Ezra Pound, and, you know, again, it's... All I'm going to say is I'm not surprised that somebody, that people have been trying to chronicle this. If anything, I'm surprised that people have been successful at it.
Right. And this was back in the mid to late 40s, I believe, or the, you know, 30s, 40s, but I'm pretty sure. Well, Pound, yeah, I think Pound was in jail until the early 50s. So... And when I say in jail, I mean, he was just kind of held against. He was never, like, tried for any charges. And I don't want to speak too much because I don't know the full story. But, I mean, he was just kind of picked up and held as a, like, a political prisoner of some sort, right? But, you know, again, Mullins went above and beyond, obviously, and got into, you know, the monopoly that Standard Oil became, and then, you know, how they created all the laws and the trust funds and the foundations, which is, you know, which we're seeing the end product of now, right? And my opinion and feeling is that, you know, even if half or 25% of what Mullins charges is true, say, you know, it's unfreaking believable. Just if like half is true, you know, it's the history that we all need to know, but are seldom, if ever, told. You know, like I mentioned, Standard Oil becoming a monopoly, Rockefeller being a bitch for Rothschild. But not only is it mind-blowing, out of control stuff that, you know, this to this day has never been remedied. But again, even if just half or less is true, it shows just how much power and control one man can have and exert upon an entire country, right? Not using a gun or a bomb or even a whole military, but using the, you know, the uber finances that they accumulated, usually through crooked and illegal means, and then creating the laws and the politicians to write them, and then subverting the justice system to enforce them. You know, so then if somebody asks, well, why is Bilderberg important? Well, there's 100 Rockefellers over there meeting this week. You know, and then think of that. You know, And I always like to point out when I'm talking to someone about Bilderberg is ask yourself if 100 of the top people in anything else were to, you know, say we're getting together for a top secret meeting and no, you can't come in and we're not telling you shit. You know, imagine that. You know, say my fellow sport freaks out there, if all the NFL owners, you know, got together for a secret meeting, would never be allowed, right? Or Jesus, I mean, imagine how this country would lose its collective mind if 100 of the biggest, richest actors got together for a secret meeting, you know, and we're told, sorry, private meeting. I actually wish that would happen because I think, what's the name of the show there? TMZ? Yeah. I think that place would literally implode if something like that were to go down.
Well, I honestly would be a little afraid because you know who'd be there is Angelina.
Hey, she's probably in Austria right now. Who are you kidding?
She's amassing her troops as we speak.
How did I not see that one coming? But you know, like I said, you know, it's 100 roughly of not the top 1%, but you know, the 0.00001%, and they get together for 3 days in a hotel, right? And it's whatever, no biggie. So I'll stop there for now, but. You know, let me just say to all the freaks out there listening, if you haven't heard of Bilderberg, ask yourself this, you know, why not?
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. Yep. Yep. I mean, that's the thing. The fact that this is that no mainstream media covers this, and it happens. I mean, you can, you know, this isn't a conspiracy theory. This actually happens.
Right.
There's plenty of evidence, you know, from all sorts of non-mainstream media. To confirm it. I mean, nobody just made this shit up. And yet, again, you never hear about it. Why is that? You're absolutely right.
And I think it was actually Rockefeller himself who in the 70s, I think, 70s, 80s, somewhere in there, he actually, you know, was at a dinner or something like that. He got quoted as saying that he would like to thank all the members of the media for allowing Bilderberg to meet in secrecy and private and not shine any lights on it so that they could, you know, get down to the business at hand. And, you know, so.
I remember seeing that, yeah.
Yeah, something like that. And then, you know, I mean, they talk about at, like, say, at that very first conference in 54. It's come out that on the agenda that day or that week was the euro, right? So they said, hey, we need a European Union. And obviously it's been speculated over the years and certain information has leaked out, but, you know, that they have plans for, you know, they had the euro and they want the Asia Union and the North American Union and the African Union, and then, you know.
Well, now, hey, though, we have to admit, you know, the euro has worked out fantastic. Just ask the people of Greece. Ask the people of Greece.
It has worked out very well for them, hasn't it? but, you know, obviously now, too, Adam, so we got, you know, you can point to and tie in Bilderberg when we have stuff like the TPP. You can bet your ass that they were discussing the TPP 10 or 20 years ago at this meeting and how to introduce it, which, as it's played out, you know, completely secret and not allowing anyone, even, you know, members of Congress to read it. And that more than anything, I just get baffled how it is in any way allowed and accepted that right now we have a president and certain people meeting on one of the biggest pieces of legislation ever. And no one is allowed to read it. And those that are, you know, the few of our elected officials that are able to actually look at it have to, you know, go into a room with just a chair and a table, you know, no phone, no recording devices. They're not allowed to ask questions, they're not allowed to speak. And then, even then, they're only allowed to review certain, you know, aspects of the legislation, not the entire body. And then when they get out of there, they're not allowed to talk to it about with anybody. It's just absolutely mind blowing. And then we have
wait now. Are you saying that you know, that they're keeping this secret because there's something nefarious going on? Say it ain't so, Crafty.
No, I'm not gonna go out on that ledge, Atomizer. I am sure that
have the best interest of the working people at heart.
Well, you know, sometimes when news is so good, you don't want to, you know, put it out there, because people will get kind of excited, and then if it doesn't really happen right away, they might get let down. So I'm sure they're just thinking of us by keeping it so secret.
Yeah, exactly. I'm sure this has nothing to do with some scam to make sure that the you know, that the rich can outsource jobs overseas without any government interference. I mean, you know, NAFTA went over so well, right?
Oh yeah, it was fantastic. I mean, the news is in on NAFTA, and that's been a nice. What are we at about that? What, 30 years now? Is it 30? 20? 20 years with NAFTA?
Yeah, I mean, you know, it's realistically these so-called trade agreements. I mean, all we're talking about is ways, you know, new ways that the rich are coming up with to get around any type of governmental interference in international trade and international labor. You know, so as to take away any public representation and any hope that the working people have of stopping their profit motivations from destroying everything we care about, whether it's our daily lives, our environment, or whatever.
Yeah. Here's the question. I don't necessarily need an answer from you, and I see that Bax is now joined in, so we'll go to him in a second. But here's the question, Atomizer, that plagues me often, right? Why not, if you're the super rich, right? If you're the 0.0001%, whatever, or you just let's say the 1%. Right,
Warren Buffett. Let's just say Warren.
Yeah, yeah. Right. Why isn't it more advantageous for them and the guys who are ultimately selling shit, right, and putting stuff out there and all that? Why isn't it more advantageous for them to have us all doing really fucking good, right? Like.
That's the sad part, is it actually is. In fact, there's a study that came out recently, and I wish I had the information on it handy. I don't. That showed that tax breaks on the rich absolutely do not help with job creation. However, tax breaks on the middle and lower income people absolutely do. You know, I think the reason is that we're dealing with this is kind of a Ponzi scheme. And the trick to a Ponzi scheme is you make as much money as quickly as you can, then you get the fuck out. And I think, you know, again, there's never any real thought towards the future, longevity, et cetera. It's a simple matter of, you know, take what you can take because the pie's only so big. And if you don't take it first, somebody else will get to it before you do. So I honestly think that's the mentality driving this. I mean, they don't want a real economy. They don't want an economical economy. They don't want something that functions to where everybody is doing well. They simply want as much money as they can possibly grab for themselves as quickly as they can fucking grab it. And I think that's where you get them making these stupid decisions where they're screwing the same workers who they depend upon to actually buy their fucking products.
Yeah, and I agree with that. And, you know, I hear the argument a lot that, you know, the better we do, obviously, would equate to things, you know, the more comfortably we are living, the less time we actually have to work would equal, right, more leisure time and thus more time to stop, look around, and actually find out who the ones are that are pulling the strings, right?
Exactly, and that's why they want to work, you know, again, that's why there's this push to literally work people to death.
Well,
I mean, you're talking about raising the retirement age now. If Warren Buffett is listening, right? And I hope he is.
And I think he is, actually. But if he's listening, he doesn't have to worry about that, right? Like, I have no problem with, you know, them having boats and houses and all that shit. I really don't. You know, I just want, you know, a 10-hour work week. Yeah, 10-hour work week and the ability to live in a decent, clean place.
But if you do that,
food?
Then he's only going to be able to have 400 boats instead of 500
Damn.
Boats. I mean, you know.
Yeah, I can see his point there, too. That's, you know, I can see that. I can see that. So, all right, Warren. All right, have your 500 boats. All right, just bend me over, baby. Bend me over. oh, fuck Atomizer. All right. Hey, let's bring Bax in, and then I just want to bring him in so he's not waiting because he can't hear the show, like the good old days of BTR. But I just want to bring him in, and then as I mentioned to you, I have a nice treat for him for our first break of the night. So,
I just want him to tell me what this vacation thing is.
Yeah, well, I have no
idea. I've never heard of that before.
Yeah, me either. But so let's just go to him, and then we'll go to break, and then we'll come back and pick this all up. So unmute him. Mr. Bax, are you there with us, my good friend? He's listening to the show, so he's delayed, I bet.
Yeah, one small little set.
Oh.
There you are. Hey,
apparently
Bax.
I have to push the mute button again for it to unmute. I don't know what's up with that. But
how are you?
I am here. I'm here.
You are here. How you doing? Welcome to the front row at the Freak Show.
I'm doing well, thank you. Sounding great, by the way. The audio is so much better.
Oh, good. Good. Actually, I'm glad to get that report. Bax, I was telling Atomizer that I know you can't listen to the show while you're on the phone, so I wanted to get you off mute and go to you, but it's time for our first break. And
I could.
Oh, nice. Oh, yeah, you can hear the conversation. That's right. I forgot. I keep forgetting that. So, we're going to go to the first break.
The sound clip, so make sure, Bax, make sure that you have your computer booted up and everything, because Crafty's got a treat for you.
Yeah, this one is just for you, Bax, all right? Bax.
Tell me when I can pop it up on I can pop it up on my phone when it's time.
What's that?
I have to boot up the Ustream app on my phone and mute the call because it won't let me listen and talk at the same time, I don't think.
Oh, right. Well, you can always catch it after. But anyway, this is George Carlin's bit on National Pride, just for you.
Awesome. Are you playing it now?
I am about to be in 3, 2, 1.
Not important to get children to read. Children who want to read are going to read. Kids who want to learn to read are going to learn to read. Much more important to teach children to question what they read. Children should be taught to question everything. To question everything they read, everything they hear. Children should be taught to question authority. Parents never teach their children to question authority because parents are authority figures themselves and they don't want to undermine their own bullshit inside the household. So they stroke the kid, and the kid strokes them, and they all stroke each other, and they all grow up all fucked up, and they come to shows like this. Yeah. Kids have to be warned that there's bullshit coming down the road. That's the biggest thing you can do for a kid. Tell them what life in this country is about. It's about a whole lot of bullshit that needs to be detected and avoided. That's the best thing you can do. No one told me. No one told me a thing like that. I was never warned about any of this. I had to find all of it out for myself. And there are still, as with you probably, a lot of things that you're expected to believe and accept in America that I personally have a problem with, and I question a lot of these things. Give you an example. I saw a slogan on the guy's car that said, "Proud to be an American." And I thought, well, what the fuck does that mean? Proud to be an American. You see, I've never understood national pride. I've never understood ethnic pride. Because I'm Irish, and I'm all four of my grandparents were born in Ireland, so I'm fully Irish. And when I was a kid, I would go to the St. Patrick's Day Parade. And I noticed that they sold a button that said, "Proud to be Irish." And I could never understand that, because I knew that on Columbus Day, they sold a different button that said, "Proud to be Italian." Then came Black Pride and Puerto Rican Pride. And I could never understand ethnic or national pride. Because to me, pride should be reserved for something you achieve or attain on your own, not something that happens by accident of birth. Being Irish... Being Irish isn't a skill. It's a fucking genetic accident. You wouldn't say, "I'm proud to be 5'11". "I'm proud to have a predisposition for colon cancer." So why the fuck would you be proud to be Irish or proud to be Italian or American or anything? Hey, if you're happy with it, that's fine. Do that. Put that on your car. Happy to be an American. Be happy. Don't be proud. Too much pride as it is. Pride goeth before a fall. Never forget Proverbs, okay? Now, here's another slogan. Here's another slogan you run into all the time. "God bless America." Once again, respectfully, I say to myself, what the fuck does that mean? God bless America? Is that a request? Is that a demand? Is that a suggestion? Politicians say it at the end of every speech, as if it were some sort of verbal tic that they can't get rid of. God bless you and God bless America. God bless you and God bless America. I guess they figure if they leave it out, someone's going to think they're bad Americans. Let me tell you a little secret about God, folks. God does not give a flying fuck about America, okay? He doesn't care. He never cared about this country. He never has. He never will. He doesn't care about this country any more than he cares about Mongolia, Transylvania, Pittsburgh, the Suez Canal, or the North Pole. He simply doesn't care, okay? He doesn't care. Listen, hey, there are 200 countries in the world now. Do these people honestly think that God is sitting around picking out his favorites? Why would he do that? Why would God have a favorite country? And why would it be America out of all the countries? Because we have the most money? Because he likes our national anthem? Maybe it's because he heard we have 18 delicious flavors of classic rice-a-roni. It's delusional thinking. It's delusional thinking. And Americans are not alone with these sort of delusions. Military cemeteries around the world are packed with brainwashed, dead soldiers who are convinced God was on their side. America prays for God to destroy our enemies. Our enemies pray for God to destroy us. Somebody's going to be disappointed. Somebody's wasting their fucking time. Could it be everyone? Yeah.
What up, freaks? Hey, you're listening to Front Row at the Freak Show. Check us out at frontrowatthefreakshow.com, at Atomizer1, at The Freak Show, and of course, Front Row at the Freak Show on YouTube and Facebook. Peace! We are back. Welcome to the Front Row at the Freak Show. I am Crafty and got on the line, as usual, Atomizer, and just recently joining us, Bax, from this thing called Vacation. So we'll check in with Bax and see what he's got going on for us this evening. And what's going on with him? If you'd like to call in and join the conversation, please call 855-355-Atomizer. 4218?
Yeah, you get me when I'm away from my screen. It's 4218 or 4128. Shit. It's one of those. I'm positive it's one of those.
Hold on. I just sent it to you.
Yeah, you're going to hit me up with questions and shit.
What is it? No, that's that one. Monday. 4218. 4218. 855-355-4218. It's up on the screen at frontrow@thefreakshow.com. So, and then, of course, access code is FreakOn. 373-2566. All right, so we have officially settled in now, I think. We hit a little G7 and a little Bilderberg. We now have Bax joining us from, he told me. Bax, where are you calling us from tonight? South Carolina? North Carolina?
Yeah, I am actually beachside in the Outer Banks at the moment.
Excellent. Excellent. How's it going?
Yeah, yeah. It's going really well. It's nice up here. It's not populated and congested as you would, like Myrtle Beach would be or something like that. It's pretty laid-back atmosphere. I see a couple flashlights on the beach, but other than that, I'm just sitting here alone.
You know, I grew up on a private beach right next to a public beach. I totally appreciate the what you're saying about, you know, not too crowded and not, it's... I much prefer the not having to step over 20 people to get to my towel kind of shit.
Absolutely. Yeah, that's one of the major reasons we come here. You know, I'm not too young anymore, so I can give a shit about the partying and the people and all that. I just want to chill.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. All right. Well, I'm pretty sure that I think you left last week, right? You had a few days, so you must have a lot of who was that guy on Saturday Night Live? Deep thoughts. Bax must have a lot
Jack
of
Candy, yeah.
Yeah, Jack Candy, deep thoughts. Bax must have a lot of deep thoughts. I didn't know when I was given the intro, Bax, if you had a backstage pass prepared for us, or if you're just looking to jump in on the conversation tonight.
Yeah, I mean, I like to jump in on the conversation. I didn't really prepare anything. I mean, I did have a couple thoughts on my way up here. I don't know if they were deep thoughts, but maybe they were. I didn't, like, do some affirmations in the mirror or something like that, but, you know.
Right.
I was driving, and I kept thinking to myself, you know, all these people in transit, you know, many of them on vacation, and a lot of them just going A to B, you know, doing their jobs or whatever it is they're doing. And I just thought, man, there are so many fucking people. There are just so many people. And each one of those people has a home and a life and a job and problems and, you know, the same exact shit that everyone else does. And I thought to myself, when this ship starts sinking or whatever happens is going to happen, I don't understand how that many people could, like, there's so much income generated because all these people do and contribute, and I know everyone doesn't, but I just thought, how in the hell do we have all these fucking people pushing this machine along, and yet they're still spending so much fucking money and doing all this fucked up shit that we are still in the position where we could fail. I mean, it's just... does that make sense? You know, when you think
it
about
does, and it's
how many people there are?
It does, and I would definitely classify that as a deep thought. you know, I mean, it can obviously serve as a little preamble to... getting back to picking up the discussion on the California drought and weather modification, you know, I don't think people realize exactly how much food California contributes, especially in the fruits and vegetables department, areas to this country, right? I mean, you're talking about 60, 70, 80% of some fruits and vegetables that pretty much only come from California. And, you know, that kind of dependency. So, you know, a couple more years of this, and it's a game changer for the entire country, right? And all those millions and millions and hundreds of millions of people you're talking about.
There's all kinds of shit going on in Northern California with other cash crops that we that I'm more concerned about. I can make my own food, motherfucker.
Yeah, you can, but you know, the you know, tons of people that Bax had brought up.
Yeah. Most of them living in cities, which are basically food deserts. Yeah.
You know, I think they say what that there's. Well, this, you know, doesn't really have to apply to the drought, but you know, they say there's about 3 days worth of food in any, you know, random supermarket out there. So, you know, anything were to happen, that obviously affects the food chain, and you'll. Like I said, game changer for the entire country. The water.
I mean, and I was thinking about which I listened to maybe about 15 minutes of the show before I called in. And basically, what I would have added to what I heard is that, you know, you're both right. It's not, there's no long term plan, not really, I don't think. I think it's just, especially the people, many of the people in office are just padding their pockets and just sucking the system dry as much as they can before they move on and get a nice piece of property and a nice supply of food and water and, you know, hard metals, whatever, just so that when something does happen, they'll be okay.
Yeah, they certainly should be able to. If, I mean, if they're not able to ride out any you know, nationwide, quote-unquote, storm, then... they're complete idiots. I'm sure most of them are well prepared. I mean, and it does. It opens up to so many avenues that we ultimately could go down, some more conspiratorial than others. You know, like when you talk about the underground bunkers that are being built. I mean, it's really hard to deny the amount of people that have come forward, you know, actual workers, military types that have come forward and said that, you know, these are real things. You know, whatever they're for, whatever they're planning, who the fuck knows? But fact remains that, you know, they are building. And when I say underground bunkers, I think I'm not doing it justice. Underground cities that.
Yeah, I think that's
that.
It's worthy of note that the research I've done has shown that. Now, granted, I can't back any up this up with proof. You know, it's all circumstantial and theory. But I have heard that there are trains, like maglev trains, that run under the ground to many of these facilities. So much so that there's virtually an underground network of facilities and bunkers where everyone would go if something major were to happen. So there still would be that continuity in place, and the people in power would be able to stay on top because
they'd
be
sheltered. Let's define everyone in that context, because I don't think we're talking about everyone at that point.
Fair enough.
Yeah,
I guess what I mean is the elite, the political and social elite. So, you know what I mean? The
folks at the Bilderberg meeting, yes.
Yeah,
exactly.
Probably, I think. Sorry to interrupt, but I think. You know, going. I think there we could use the 1% number. I mean, to talk about what 1%? What's 1% of Americans? What's that number? 35.
Like 3,500 people or something.
No,
right?
35. It would be 350,000. Would be 1%, right?
Okay.
It sounds, you know, if you spread that out across the country, I've heard the same things too. Again, I'll go back to what I was talking about with Eustace Mullins. If only half or less is correct about what you hear with these underground networks, then there's a lot of shit going on there, right? I mean, I think there's something to it. And I think even Jesse Ventura on one of his conspiracy theory shows did a great job of getting in and, you know, got pseudo preliminary access to one of them or something. He had some shots from the inside, or someone produced them for him or something like that. But I mean, there's something to it, right? There is. They are digging, and you know, again, like the TPP or like what happens at Bilderberg, we don't, you know, it's on a need to know basis, and we don't need to know.
Did you ever see that thing when Jesse Ventura was first running for governor, and they had him, they did an interview with him on the Daily Show, because, you know they used to do those kind of joke interviews where the joke was on the interviewee, and he wasn't in on it, and they actually had him say, you know, they were saying, well, I think the question was something to the effect of, you know, well, why do you think the voters are going to vote for you? And he actually came out and said, well, the voters are stupid.
Oh, I love Freudian slip.
And he still pulled it off.
Exactly. Yeah, I guess he was right.
You know, well, hey, just like the Obama guy, right, who and that was pretty recently, who the one of the main writers or creators of Obamacare, the actual legislation. I mean, he came out and pretty much said that we're all stupid. Or they counted on our stupidity to be able to pass the bill, I guess is a better way to say it, and how he said it.
Yeah, that's pretty much exactly what he said.
Right. So,
I mean, when you have Nancy Pelosi standing in front of everyone saying, we have to pass it so we can find out what's in it. I mean, what kind of ignorant shit is that to say on the floor of the Congress? And everybody's like, oh, okay.
Oh, it's mind-blowing. And I could just go to YouTube right now and, you know, type in Obama transparency and, you know, have him touting himself as the most transparent president ever. He might be right, actually, about that. Maybe it's all in the wording, right? But, you know, when you're talking about it, I mean, it's come pretty clear to me what, you know, Obama, and speaking of Bilderberg, him, both he and Hillary, if you remember, back in 2008, when it was getting, well, must have been June of that year, but it was an election year, so there was, and it was still relatively early in the election year, obviously being in June. But they were still on the campaign trail. And for a day or two, they both went missing. And there was all this speculation as to where they were and what they were doing. And
I think they both got a case of the jungle fever. But
yeah. Well, I think you're right, but they did it. They did it at the right. At the Bilderberg meeting that year, which was in Virginia, actually, that year.
They probably just ate a baby or something.
So, and then had jungle fever.
When it comes, you know, when it comes to Hillary, I mean, what an example of everything that's wrong with the Democratic Party. And quite honestly, you know, Obama turned out to be no better. For all of his promises of change and, you know, at least seemed to have socialist leanings and everything else, you know what I mean? And then he gets in there, and it's friggin', you know, you might as well have a right-winger in there. What the hell difference does it make? You know, he made sure he scratched the banks' backs. He made sure that when people start talking about universal health care, that instead he pushed through a tax on the poor. You know, it's now I'm not saying that it's right for these crazy right-wingers to blame everything, you know, most of which Congress is doing, on the president, and to act like everything wrong in their lives is because of the black guy. I'm just saying that, you know, he has turned out to be a very weak president, in the sense that, you know, when he got in there and he found out, hey, you've got bosses, you've got campaign donors you've got to answer to, suddenly everything that we thought we were going to see fell by the wayside. And, you know, if you think you're going to get anything different out of Hillary, you're wrong. Support Bernie Sanders. That's what I think.
I can't even believe she is even thought about as a potential. But that's what, you know, I kind of cut off my thought.
Just say, I wonder, let me just say, I agree with you 100%. When you look at the bullshit like Benghazi, and then they bring up all this shit about her campaign funding and the organization that she runs and the overseas account and, you know, all this shit is being brought out, thrown out, even in the drive-by media, and people are just, it's just being glossed over and glazed over.
Sorry, I had. Were you hearing that, Bax? I'm sorry to cut you off, but your phone was acting all sorts of funny. Did you hear that, Atomizer?
It sounded fine on my end until you cut him off.
I mean, I was just getting like alien Bax or something like that. It was like going through some. Let me just give it a shot again. Bax, sorry about that. You there with us, buddy?
I am.
Okay. Oh, that sounds better. It was just I was getting all sorts of weird audio from you, so I'm sorry to do that, but go on with your rant. I probably took the wind out of your sails.
Basically, just agreeing. You know, I mean, there's all this evidence that comes out when you look at the things that are happening with her campaign funding and her organizations that are allegedly helping impoverished people and nations, and she's obviously draining, you know, the campaign funds from these organizations and moving money around, and the whole Benghazi thing was just horrible. But it's like none of it can touch her. It doesn't matter what they say, because that's going to be our next president, it seems like.
Yeah, I think it's absolutely ridiculous the way they, and you know, you got to remember, she sat on the board of Walmart. She voted for Monsanto in every friggin' vote that ever came up. She voted for the Iraq War. She is fucking believable. And for the media to have suddenly crowned her Miss Democrat, and to the point where, you know, when Bernie Sanders comes up, he's almost a footnote, and they're saying, oh, well, you know, he'll move the debate to the left, and they'll talk about the idea that he actually has a fucking chance. I mean, you know, who's going to be the candidate? It's not the media.
Because we all know that it goes way deeper than that. But just those things alone should be enough for people to say, whoa, no, stop. But it's not.
Right, and you know, and I just want to say for the record, I could give a shit if she's a woman. I mean, if Bernie Sanders had a vagina, I'd vote for him anyway. I don't care. You know, I really don't care. I would certainly vote for Warren over Clinton, though not over Bernie Sanders. I have voting for a woman. I have no problem, you know, voting for anybody that will actually do what they say they're going to do. But for her to get up there and pretend like she's a champion of the fucking poor, and the disenfranchised is insane to me, and the people are buying it is even more crazy.
It really is, and I apologize, fellas, and apologize to those listening. I think we had a little disconnect there from the stream, and I think that's actually why you, Atomizer, were coming in with alien voice on my end as well. So it probably went out fine, like you heard Bax fine, but it looks like we had lost our stream for a little bit there. But no, yeah, I mean, I think you're absolutely right. And unless you mentioned it in that 30 seconds there, I mean, everything you brought up didn't even really get to mention, you know, all her latest shit with the finance contributions and acting as Secretary of State and accepting money from foreign nations. And yeah,
hey, he's back. Crafty's back.
Could you not hear me?
Yeah, you dropped off for like a good, you know, almost a minute there, and I wasn't even sure if the whole thing dropped. I'm just like, did we lose him? And then I heard backstalking, and I'm like, yeah, I guess we did.
Wow. Okay, and I see we're disconnected again from the thing. So it's kind of like a habit that I'm getting, like 1 hour, you know, a little more than an hour into it, just like the other night, is when the, you know, we've been fine connection-wise. I haven't changed anything on my computer end, and I hope it's not just another battle for the entire night, you know, on connectivity issues. But Anyway, I was just mentioning Hillary, and I don't, because I don't think you had mentioned it. You know, it doesn't even, you didn't even touch on all our latest stuff as, you know, Secretary of State and all the contribution, the campaign contributions, and what's his name, the guy of the who's the media guy that used to be Clinton's, one of his advisors, Stephanopoulos, no. You guys know who I'm talking about?
Bush, I think.
What's that?
Wasn't Stephanopoulos Bush?
Now, who's the guy, you know, he does Good Morning America or whatever, one of those shows, and he got caught contributing $75,000 to Hillary and, you know, all the stuff that's coming out, as I was saying, while she was Secretary of State and all these foreign...
Was it Brian Gumbel?
Greg Gumbel. and it wasn't Chris Berman,
man.
And it wasn't
Gumbel to Gumbel, you know.
It wasn't Chris Berman, or it wasn't. no, it was. What's Stephanakos? Who's the guy? Oh man, you guys are gonna make me figure this out on my own, aren't you? Media. Money to Hillary. Of course, it doesn't come up. All right, whatever. I don't know. What's his name? Gave money to Hillary. So, we're once again going down this hole, fellas. And, you know, we really got to start talking some weather modification since it is the topic for this evening.
Works for me. I boned up on that a little bit this week.
Excellent. Excellent. Glad you boned up on that. So, tell you what. Let's take a break here. Let's take our second break, and then we'll come back, and we will dive into, we'll take calls, and really sink our teeth into weather modification. How's that sound?
Works for me.
All right, fantastic. I am dipping back into last week's well because I was told the audio from the comedy and the tune when I played MC5 was completely butchered for most people. So, and I also did want to point out because I had this preloaded and ready for last week. That kind of a new, I guess, little segment to the front row at the Freak Show here. And that is right before the music, got a little intro of the music from a new contributor to the front row. And that's Johnny Freedom. And Johnny is an old friend of mine, a fan and supporter of the front row. And as you may have guessed, all things, well, freedom. He is also one of, if not the smartest pricks I know when it comes to rock and roll and all its varied, wonderful, and of course, just crazy-ass history. So I really have absolutely no reservations calling him a true rock aficionado and historian. He has certainly turned me on to countless bands and musicians over the years. And actually, I don't think I've even ever told this to him. But Johnny Freedom virtually rescued me, I would say, from a life of pretty bad music. As my early high school days, well, let's just say I was listening to some not good shit. But I don't even think I'm brave enough to mention it on there. But anyway, so I did want to play. He had a great intro to the MC5, and I wanted to make sure that got heard here in the front row, so we will play that and then come back after the tune with some weather modification talk with Bax and Atomizer. All right, let's, what do I got to do? Oh, yeah. And here you go.
Howdy, freaks. It's your pal, Johnny Freedom. I want to bring you back to the tumultuous year of 1968, when Elektra Records signed two hard-edge bands from the Motor City. Of the two, the larger advance went to the MC5, very much in demand a product of a bidding war from different labels that were anxious to get the band on their roster. The smaller sum went to Iggy Pop's band, The Stooges. And while The Stooges went on to leave a more lasting legacy and remain relevant to this very day, the MC5 have been largely forgotten. It's a shame, really, because the Five were a truly great rock and roll band. Unfortunately, after aligning themselves with the radical politics of their manager, the notorious John Sinclair, the Five became more trouble than they were worth to many record companies, label execs, and people in the industry, promoters, who didn't really want to deal with them and the problems that always came with the MC5 and Sinclair. They were also part of the radical group, the White Panther Party, which was an answer to the Black Panther Party, which you freaks can learn more about through your Googles. So after pissing off the record company for not only using the word fuck on their record, but also in an advertisement that caused a major Midwest record chain to pull all their records from the shelves, the Five had gained a well-earned reputation for being a bunch of guys you're wise not to trifle with. That, of course, doesn't help your career. So turning their back on money in favor of politics caused them to go three and out, washing out of the music business after only three records. Time has been a little kinder to the Five, as their subversive politics and incendiary approach has been immortalized in print and has influenced many a band, including future shit stirrers such as Rage Against the Machine. The song I'm about to play could very well be an unofficial anthem for us here on the front row. Sit back and dig The American Ruse.
Trying to be free, they never let you. They said it's easy, nothing to it. And now the army's out to get you. 69 American terminal stasis. The air so thick it's like a drowning in molasses. I'm sick and tired of paying these dues. And I'm finally getting hip to the American ruse. I'm going to say the pledge of allegiance before they beat me bloody. They haven't got a word out of me since I got a billion years probation. 69 American criminals passes. The air so thick it's like a drowning in molasses. I'm sick and tired of paying these dues. And I'm sick to my guts of the American ruse. Pony star.
Oh no.
Comic car.
Oh no.
Cheap guitar.
We're back, and that was Johnny Freedom introducing the MC5 American Ruse. Good tune, and I don't know if you guys had the pleasure of being able to listen to it, but definitely got the rock going.
I got to catch the little bit at the beginning there, but I'm on a slow connection, so my feed doesn't work all that great.
I hear you.
I will go back and listen to it later.
Fantastic. That's all I ask, Ben.
Oh, and can we do that, Crafty? Are these back episodes going to be available?
Yes. And I know that the last couple from BTR need to be posted. I had a problem with one of them, and then I've just been so busy with this stuff. But and I'm trying to work on getting it so, like, on the website when you know the archive versions, just like an audio stream, nice, real simple design. That, just load and just click the play button and have it go like that. So I'm trying to download the right, player and stuff like that onto the site. So, which I imagine I will be taking care of this week. So, yes, Bax, good question. Archives, of course, will still be here. And I believe they should be on Ustream as well. I am recording this to the Ustream channel, so at the very least, they will be captured on ustream.tv/channel/frontrowatthefreakshow with a hyphen in between each word. Nice. Answer your question?
Weather modification.
Yes. Yes. Excellent, Atomizer. Right to it. I love it. Okay, so, I think first and foremost, we have to ask the question, right, if we're going to be talking about weather modification, and or especially if it applies possibly to the drought that's in California, we have to ask the first question, right? And that's, is it possible?
Well, I think on that question, at least the research that I've been doing, the question, is it possible? Absolutely. I think that if you look into, what is being done, what sort of experiments have been done, laws that have been passed, et cetera, with regards to weather modification, it not only can it happen, it is happening. I mean, there are certainly, people have been cloud seeding since forever. I mean, that's a weather modification. It's
Correct.
Really not that big a stretch to think of it on the scale of even a large state like California, that any number of things could be used to do that. They've done, not just cloud seeding either. Storm control, trying to lessen hurricanes. There's all sorts of projects that have gone on to various degrees of success and calamity when it comes to weather modification. I mean, it's, we're humans. We think we can control nature. Why wouldn't we?
Right. Right. Bax, anything to add to that? I mean, I think I can provide a little actual historical data, but didn't know if you had anything to add on to what Atomizer just said.
I agree with him. I mean, I think that if you take the view that it's not possible, then that's just simply ignorant. I mean, and I don't typically ever call people ignorant. I try not to do that, even though I may think it. It's been happening for a long time. I mean, at the earliest, we'll say the 40s. And, people have to take into consideration the reason that it started was in a time of war. It wasn't simply just to help farmers and create rain. It was in the hopes that they could control the weather, because if you can control the weather, then, I mean, you have a decided advantage in any situation. I mean,
absolutely. And there have been weather weaponization experiments going on since forever. And again, why not? If it's even remotely possible, why wouldn't they try it?
Yeah, I mean, it's a force multiplier. I mean, it is what it is. And you remember Forrest Gump when he was talking about it rained, big old fat rain, and it rained sideways and up from the ground?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah.
It was a veiled reference, I think, to the Project Popeye that was.
Yes.
It rained and rained and rained, and it was like the 1960s modification. And I think, if I read it rightly, a guy named Seymour Hersh blew the lid on it, and I'm not sure. I would have to look it up. But yeah, I mean, it's been going on. It's happened, and they are trying to use it for military purposes. I mean, like, you know, why wouldn't they? You're right. So I think it is happening. On what scale, I don't know. Do I believe that I see chemtrails? I think maybe it's possible. Some of them, yeah. I don't think it's all contrails, you know, but it's
I balk when we hit the chemtrail thing. And I say that having searched high and low throughout, you know, various portions of this week and in the past for any actual evidence of the chemtrail thing, and I'm just not finding it. I'm not saying, again, I'm the first to say I think they are modifying weather. I think they're using all sorts of devices to do that. But the mass scale chemtrail thing, I stop at that one because, again, I'm just not seeing the evidence. And if either of you have something to present that maybe I haven't seen or haven't been able to find, by all means, I'm happy to listen. But, you know, again, I just cannot find the evidence of it anywhere.
Well, there's literally thousands of pictures.
Pictures of contrails. I mean, no picture is going to prove what the content of that is. And just because a contrail lingers, which they are scientifically proven to do, does not make it a chemtrail.
No. I absolutely, wholeheartedly, 1,000% disagree. When you have literally a checkerboard in the sky for hours, atomizer, that is not contrails. And from my understanding,
how do you know that? What are you basing that on?
From the research and information that I have, various places. I have seen multiple times that even contrails themselves really shouldn't exist with the way engines are designed currently. That just normal exhaust. I mean, look at planes going. Why do some planes, I mean, you look up in the sky after a plane and there isn't a line. Right? Some planes do them and some planes don't. Some planes, they go away after.
Are basically, as I understand it, very lay terms, are simply condensation basically shearing off of the plane, or should I say gathering on the plane and then shearing off. But there's it's going to happen, the different atmospheric conditions, different heights of planes, different speeds of planes, all of these things are going to have an effect as to whether you see a contrail, you don't see a contrail, whether that contrail persists, whether it spreads, you know. This all, I'm looking and I don't see anything illegitimate to any of the science behind that.
Well, once again,
did you find the evidence of when they track one of these, you know, con or chemtrail, you call it what you want, but they actually tracked it across the eastern seaboard over, like, several states?
There is plenty of video evidence, and again, I'll just point to Dane Wigington and his site, geoengineering.org, and if you go there, look at all the links. They have video evidence of planes turning on and off their condensation. It just caught on videotape right there. And he gives a fantastic, he actually hates the term chemtrail. He's like, it's not a proper term. It's cloud seeding. It's different things. And then the reason why I like his site and the work that he's done, I mean, he's collected the evidence from all sorts of independent researchers, independent meteorologists, independent whatever their titles are, and getting the readings of the ground and the air and the water, within hours, days, weeks after these planes have been spotted, and the increased levels of aluminum, the increased levels of all the different chemicals and metals that they're spraying with. So, I think that evidence is not a problem if you choose to look at it. And
no, I mean, again, I did look. I looked for it. I also looked. I did look at that site, and I'm just not seeing anything concrete there. I mean, you you can say, okay, here's a video of them turning it on, turning it off, okay?
Mm-hmm.
But again, it's a simple matter. That's one possible explanation, absolutely. There are certainly other possible explanations. I mean, you know, for all we know, it's a jet that just kicked on its afterburner, or they just hit a pocket of moisture, or any number of things could easily explain that. And, you know, to me, the whole, when it comes to the chemtrail thing, is, you know, again, there's no, you can talk about, oh, well, you know, we see this on the ground and blah, blah, blah. And again, I did not see anything, any conclusive evidence of you know, I did find one thing about how they tested, I don't remember whether it was the ground or the air. And they said that, the barium levels were off the charts or something like that. And then video of them doing that later showed that they were misusing the device. Now, you know, again, I have yet to see anything, any single, you know, it's just because we, you know, you talk about, the first thing that you talked about was we see, you know, the checkerboard patterns, or we see, you know, we see it persisting, this, that, and the other thing. But again, I don't feel like I'm qualified enough. I guess I'm going to just say this. I don't feel like I'm qualified enough to refute the scientists who have looked at all of this and said it's contrails.
Well, who are those scientists, though? Give me the name of one scientist who's come out and said,
give me
a contrail.
Give me 10 seconds on Google, and I will. I mean... I'll pull it up right now.
You know, how come? All right.
The official position of every, you know, can you point to any any single, and I'm not just talking military or government based, but even private based, even, you know, can you point to a single agency of any kind, any group, any scientific organization that has confirmed or that doesn't say that chemtrails are bullshit?
Well, again, chemtrails isn't an accepted term within those groups. They don't even use the word chemtrail. It's all
okay, but
it's
the
all
idea
clock.
Of mass
so,
chemical
but,
spraying of the air.
Let's back this up.
Use whatever term you want.
Let's back this up a second, okay? Let's back this up because we're going down a road here of arguing. One, a term, okay? And then, so we're just talking about, now, you started when I asked you, is it possible and are they doing it? Okay? And
weather
you seemed,
modification. Weather modification.
Well, that is ultimately what we're talking about here. How else do they modify the weather outside of HAARP? Which, from my lay opinion, works in coordination with the cloud seeding.
But okay, then again, what are you basing that on?
Just the various things I have read and watched. I mean, I have watched hundreds of hours. I have read articles. I don't know. Two dozen, three dozen, various sources.
There was a congressional meeting where they said, we control the ionosphere. Okay? Whether you choose to believe that, it doesn't really matter, because when it comes down to it, none of the shit we talk about we can really prove beyond a reasonable doubt. And I think we all know that there's scientists on multiple subjects who are paid to perpetuate scientific data in any sort of favor, whether it be the FDA or whatever organization we're talking about. Do I think every trail that looks funky to me is a chemtrail? No. But do I think that there are chemtrails, if that's what you want to call them? Yeah. There's some shit that looks weird and to me does not seem like it should fucking be there that long. And I've seen videos and read stuff. I can't cite it. I'm walking on the beach. I should have done my homework more. I do apologize, but...
Let me say
I've
this.
I've read plenty of data.
let me say this. And this is going... I went right to geoengineeringwatch.org. He's got a link on that page titled Documents. You go onto that document page, there's another link that says U.S. patents relating to geoengineering. Okay, and this page that comes up is a list. And when you click on them, each one is, you know, it's just a list straight down of about 100-150 United States patents starting in 1920. Do you want me to read you the first few here, Atomizer? April 27th.
Hey, give me something.
April 27th, 1920, patent number 1338343. The process, and I said 1920, by the way. The process and apparatus for the production of intense artificial clouds, fogs, or mists. March 1st, 1927. Process of producing smoke clouds from moving aircraft. April 10th, 1928. Process of producing artificial fogs. May 1st, 1934. Airplane spray equipment. October 15th, 1946.
All you seem to be proving is that yes, they can spray things.
Okay, so planes. All right, so I they mean, wait, hold on, hold
that.
On, no, hold
we
on,
know
hold
they
on.
Can spray they things
they,
for planes and
they can do it.
The question is, are they doing it on a mass scale?
Okay, they can do it, and the technology, as we're seeing, has been around for almost 100 years.
Right, yes, they can.
Okay, hold on, let me finish. They can do it. Okay? They documents have been declassified as them, you know, as Bax pointed out, Operation Popeye, literally changing the weather in Vietnam during the war there. So they can do it. So all I'm sitting here saying, and I'm really wondering here, is, let's see, and then when you add in the photo and video evidence from just thousands of sources, may some of them be Photoshop? Yeah. But there's thousands and tens of thousands of pictures and thousands of videos showing what
again,
is clearly, clearly not.
What is it in those videos that proves that this is some chemical being sprayed? Versus contrast.
Atomizer, when I see a checkerboard, when I see a checkerboard in the sky perfectly aligned for hours, that is not contrails of plane. You know, I mean, look up in the sky and watch a regular, because I've seen planes look up in the sky and just a regular contrail, if there is one, lasts at most a couple of minutes. At most.
That's scientifically disproven, though, and I can pull it up right now and tell you. Let me see. Give me just a minute here, but I can absolutely pull it up. That this whole idea that contrails don't persist under any atmospheric conditions is absolute crap.
Atomizer, that they may on occasion, when you're talking about a day, so you're talking about on one day when someone captured a picture, it just happened to be 14 planes that crisscrossed each other that all had condensation trails that lasted the same amount of time? Is that what you're telling me?
I think if you're near an airport,
I mean,
come on. On a given day where the atmospheric conditions are right, and for, you know, or any place that's heavily air trafficked, then absolutely you're going to see that. I mean, why wouldn't you expect that?
Because you don't see them even normally. You're telling me that it takes
contrails persisting, and if you happen to be on that day near an airport, what do you expect to see?
So all those days are the days that we're getting all this data in these pictures. It just happens to line up with the perfect atmospheric conditions. And then we get the pictures, and that's what we're seeing.
We're not talking about something that we have any reason to believe is a rare atmospheric condition.
Atomizer, okay, next week, and I'll produce 100 photos if you want that aren't near airports, and they're all at different altitude levels, and you can just, you know, look at the patterns in the skies. And
you have to consider other possibilities here. You have to consider the simple possibility. Okay. Maybe there's an Air Force drill. Maybe there's any number of reasons that you're seeing this many planes in a particular vicinity. To jump from the fact that you're seeing persistent, whatever it may be, okay, contrails, chemtrails, or something, whatever you want to call it, to the idea that, you know, this is some sort of weaponized geoengineering, not necessarily weaponized, but some sort of weather modification thing. Not to say that weather modification doesn't happen, but that this somehow points to a mass scale weapon, weather modification. I think that's an awfully big leap. I mean, we're supposed to be skeptical here, right?
Persistent contrails. I am skeptical of the people that have been in power and control over this last 100 years that have consistently lied to us, have consistently...
As am I.
Who I am skeptical of. So when I look at all the circumstances, when I look at that they have had patents for 100 years, when I have seen that they have documented already done and used this system, when I see that it's been 40 years since they came out with a treaty, that forces nations not to be able to change the weather of other countries. Doesn't say anything about what you can do in your own country. And I just start adding up, and then the photo evidence, and then the video evidence, and then the evidence of the elevated things of exactly... all the elevated counts of the metals that these guys are getting from the air and the water and the land after these contrails go by just happen to be the metals that are listed in the patents for the aerosols that they applied for 60 years ago. So I'm sorry if that all adds up to me being skeptical that these aren't contrails, but I have no other choice but to go down that road.
So let me ask you guys this. Let's be clear here. So, Atomizer, are you saying that, let's say that we took in 1 year all the pictures that were found and all of the ideas from people who believe that there are chemtrails and that the things they're seeing are chemtrails? Are you willing to say that it's possible that maybe 33% of those have something to do with some kind of project that we're unaware of and unable to produce any factual evidence? Or are you more in the line of believing that none of it are chemtrails? There are no chemtrails. It's just we're not seeing things the right way. And we're assuming that something is going on when in actuality it's probably just something to do with the atmospheric conditions.
Atomizer? Did we lose him?
Sorry, I muted myself. I thought I unmuted myself.
Yeah.
Anyway, I look upon this stuff. I'm not denying the possibility, okay? That's not, don't mistake me. It's certainly a possibility, okay, that what we're seeing in some of these persistent chemtrails, especially groups of them, okay, is weather modification. Small scale, large scale, okay. It's certainly possible, all right. I certainly know that, you know, it is happening in some places, obviously. We know that they are doing these experiments, okay. I have no question that there are people out there flying planes and spraying shit into the sky, all right. But is that such a common phenomena as seems to be the case with those who are founding whole websites dedicated to whether they want to call them chemtrails or what have you? Is it really this massive scale thing of some secret project, or is it just, again, some of these are experiments, others are simple contrails? And again, I just don't see anything that points to this massive conspiracy of any kind of large scale
weather manipulation. Now, do I think it's happening in small areas? I know it's happened in small areas. Okay, I know it's happened historically in various, you know, all over the world. Okay, but again, it seems to me that the conspiracy that's being discussed most of the time when I'm discussing with people who are into the chemtrail thing or whatever they want to call it, okay, is this idea that, you know, it's this global thing that they're doing, you know, every single day, everywhere they can do it. And I just don't see that, you know. I just don't see that. I see some rare one-off pictures, okay, whether it's 100 in a year or whatever. I mean, you know, again, globally, 100 pictures in a year really isn't that much. All right. I have no doubt that they're running a lot more than 100 different experiments with this sort of stuff in any given year. Okay. But there's a big difference between experimenting with weather modification and jumping to the conclusion that there's some giant conspiracy behind all of this, that they're seeding the, you know, that they're causing a California drought or whatever else. You know, again, that to me is just a huge, huge jump. That I'm
so basically, the discrepancy is, in your mind, the scale of it. It's not just the scale of the conspiracy and the scale of the actual activity.
Exactly. Those are the two things that I question. I question what? The idea of whether or not this really is. And not to say again, I'm not anti-conspiracy, okay? But I just question the fact because I don't see any evidence coming to light of the conspiracy, right? Of any grand scale, large scale conspiracy. And I don't see, you know, any evidence of a large scale plane. I see evidence of, you know, okay, here's a picture of some area where there was a bunch of it going on in a certain weather pattern. I've seen those pictures, okay, in this area or that area or whatever else. But to me, the difference between, you know, who's to say that that's not just the latest weather modification experiment, even if, you know, again, even if they are, if we are talking weather modification, who's to say that's not just, okay, we're going to go try a new weather modification experiment, we're going to send, you know, 20 planes up and they're going to spray this and we're going to see what happens or whatever else. Now, that, again, I don't have a huge issue, I do have a huge issue, because I don't think we should be toying with that in general, but as I say, when I'm talking to folks, and I do quite often, who are buffs, I would say, in this particular conspiracy, you know, again, they seem to believe that, again, there is this grand conspiracy going on of almost a global weather modification thing that I just don't see the evidence for. That's where I get lost. I'm not saying they're not spraying things. Of course they are. You know,
all right, well,
they're doing it in some conspiracy on a grand scale. I just don't see the evidence.
Well, okay. So, first of all, when we started this off,
where that evidence is.
Yeah, but first of all, when we started this off, I never mentioned grand conspiracy.
No, and I'm not saying you did. That's why I'm not referring.
And let me just hold on. 855-355-4218. If you'd like to join the conversation, we'd love to hear from you. Access code freak on. But I think we could have saved ourselves a lot of breath there, because, you know, again, I never said that there was this grand conspiracy. Okay, I mean, it was just getting to the existence of spraying, right?
I don't think we're all three far apart. I think we're closer together than we realize, but that's why I wanted to clarify.
When we talk about being skeptical, right? And you brought it up, Atomizer.
Yes.
Okay? I'm going down my list here, and I'm saying, okay, they've had the ability. They've proven they would use it and have used it. Okay? There are just all sorts of documentation coming up that speaks to their ability and willingness to do it. Okay? And I combine that, and yes, I will fully wholeheartedly admit, I mean, obviously, I am a complete dumbass when it comes to actual scientific knowledge of what is needed or whatever, you know, and the results and all that. So I am relying heavily on this gentleman that I've mentioned several times, Dane Wigginton. But from all the stuff that I've read from him and his lectures that I have heard and watched, he presents a very convincing case, okay, loaded with charts, graphs, readings, data,
but what is,
collected from all different, what's that?
I say, what is the case? What is it that he believes is happening? I mean,
ultimately, I guess when it comes down to it, this is his theory, I think, in a nutshell, is that they were kind of doing kind of how you were talking about it through the 40s, 50s, and 60s, right? A lot of experimenting, figuring out what the fuck was what affects what, right? And that they fucked up. And now they are trying to fix that fuck up. But according to him, their fix is just another fuck up. And now they are really fucking things up. how's that for layman?
That's the part where, again, I feel like the conspiracy comes into play. And that's where I ask, you know, again, what is the evidence of this fuck?
Well, you'd have to, I mean, I can't give you all the evidence right now. If you go on to Geoengineering Watch to listen to one or two, I mean, he's got 100 lectures on there where he, you know, goes through and he sources all his data. He references anally about where he's getting all his information from. I mean, he just goes right down the list. Like I said, yeah, I'm relying heavily on this guy, but so
I mean, give me at a summary level, just give me what is it that he's basing this whole, oh, there was a fuck up and now they're trying to fix that fuck up thing. I mean,
I think he's just going on
takes weather patterns and data.
Yeah, exactly. Weather,
some of the things.
Right.
Weather patterns and data over the past, like, you know, since the 40s, and
jet streams and ionosphere conditions, and I mean, his data points are, I mean, he's got hundreds of them, and you know, it's like I said, you have to sit through a couple of his lectures. I mean, and that's what they are. They're slideshow PowerPoint presentations. Huh?
But do you think that his conclusions that he's apparently drawn based on this data that he's presenting are the only possible explanation?
No, I don't. Here's what I am pretty sure of, though.
Okay.
I'm pretty sure that the California drought is a byproduct of what they were doing. Now, intended or not, I'm not really talking about intent, right? I don't know if any one or 10 people sat around a table and said, let's bring a drought down on California, okay?
Right.
But I do believe that...
If they did.
Huh?
I say it would actually be an excellent marketing strategy if they did, but...
Right. But I do believe it is a byproduct of weather modification. Okay, he gets very specific, and not just him. On this, there's a few other sources as well that, you know, they show, you know, and you got to kind of watch it yourself, whatever. But they show that 200 miles off the coast of California, the jet stream and ionosphere levels and testing the seawater below it and everything else in between, the tests are reading completely opposite of what they should be reading. And things are acting completely opposite of the way they should be acting. or have historically acted, let's say, for over a, you know, a thousand, however far back they can go with their data. Obviously, they're not just always constrained to data that they actually have, but, you know, they can go back hundreds of years in some cases for some things. But anyway, so I fully believe that the California drought is at least a byproduct of what's been going on. You know, again, when you add in atomizer, things like, you know, you had the Enron scandal of, you know, what did they start off doing? It was they ran this whole electricity scam, right, on people. And, you know, I'm not even necessarily, it's not like I'm pinning this on the government or whatever, but I mean, geez, it really doesn't take much when you think about it. When you're talking some chemicals in a couple of airplanes, any one of these, you know, one percenters or whatever could, you know,
logistically put that together.
Absolutely. Yeah. You know, and when you're talking things like weather,
here's what I wonder. Let me see if I can sum it up. Here's my concern, okay? Because I've seen a lot of different scenarios of, you know, what may or may not be called conspiracy theories or whatnot, where the conclusion, okay, is what comes first, and then they go out and find the, you know, look for the evidence that supposedly supports this conclusion, which is, of course, not the way that science is done, okay?
Sure.
You don't put the conclusion first, okay? You look at the evidence, all right? You examine the different possibilities that could explain this evidence,
mm-hmm.
okay? And then you come up with hypotheses to test each one of those.
Yeah.
Okay. Now it seems to me, and again, I'm happy to look at you know, without spending hundreds of hours watching, you know, lectures from this guy or anybody else, because I really don't have that kind of time. But you know, I'm more than happy to look at it from the perspective of, okay, you know, here's the hypothesis. You know, we see this evidence, we see these anomalies, let's say. Okay, so we're going to work the hypothesis.
Mm-hmm.
What if this is some sort, you know, what if this is chemicals being sprayed, et cetera, you know, on some type of massive scale because of some fuck up or whatever else. You know, where do you draw the line, I guess, between that being conjecture, you know? I mean, mm-hmm. I just wonder. You know, it seems to me like it's one possible explanation for a bunch of evidence that I do believe he has, a bunch of data that I do believe he has, I should say, of all sorts of anomalies. But again, I just wonder, is he, I mean, you've spent the time listening to him and I assume to others. Are you completely ruling out the possibility that he's jumping to the conclusion he wants to versus... you know, looking at all of the possible causes, things that might have caused these kind of anomalies and this kind of data.
Is it feasible that these scientists would come together and investigate and then point their big finger towards the government and the hand that feeds them, though, on that same... You know what I mean? Like, I'm not saying that is it, but, I mean, let's be honest. If it was the government and if it was a big, huge conspiracy... There's not going to be a big group of scientists that come together and then put forth all this data that points the big grody finger at the hand that feeds them. They're not going to do that.
Well, I mean, you know, look, how many scientists and engineers have come out about Tower 7? Just one example. You know what I mean? And said that's
and how many people
not
believe that
possible.
Shit?
You know what I mean?
Hold on, fellas. Let's back up because for purposes of the show, right? My goal and objective here tonight is mostly to state that this is one possibility. And I want everyone listening to go and research it for themselves to find out what they think, right? And as I said, this gentleman, Dane Wigington, has made a fantastic case, okay? I would love to hear other cases, but talking about weather modification in general terms, okay, I think then my reasoning kind of shifts at least again for the purposes of the show, to where I say what I think a lot of people, even people that are familiar with the alt media things that we bring up, the conspiratorial things that we discuss, I think a lot of this weather modification stuff is relatively new or newer information. I mean, at least it was for me, right? It wasn't certainly the first thing I heard of. I mean, you've kind of always heard chemtrails being bounced around or whatever, but, you know, again, you know, going in and looking at this list of approved United States patents that have been going on since the 20s, then you find out about something like Operation Popeye that Bax mentioned, and the UN treaty that goes against the use of weaponized weather in 1976. There was mainstream media or a cable program, that I forget which one offhand, but they had put out a show saying that the last California drought, the one, or maybe not the last one, but there was one, I guess, late 80s, early 90s, that they blamed, or the TV show was conjecturing, was actually Russia using a weather modification system to create that drought on California. Let me just finish up here, Atomizer, I'm just bringing these things to light. So I kind of have two different things going here. One, just talking about weather modification, stated, documented evidence for it existing and its use, and then the possibility that it could have been used to create this California drought.
But isn't there a much simpler explanation for the California drought, which is simple resource mismanagement?
I think that would... Yeah, not really, because I think that would... I think they could have prepared better, sure. Yeah, absolutely. I think it could be a lot less devastating than it is if they, took proper reservoir building and management over the last 30, 40 years and didn't allow the fracking rules to spoil the groundwater and Nestle to have privatized water rights. Yeah, absolutely. I think that, it could be a situation they could probably maybe even ride out. But it would still be a drought, right? There would still be no rain. A lot of the basins would still be empty and whatnot. They would just have more in reserve to fall back on, or different, things to go there. So,
if they had properly managed it, okay, if they had actually thought back, planned ahead, etc., for example, had a reservoir system, okay,
mm-hmm.
Wouldn't that reservoir water then be available to be evaporated up into the sky and come back down as rain? I mean, the drought, I'm not just talking about the idea that better resource management could have allowed them to ride out the drought. I'm talking, couldn't better resource management have even allowed them to at least lessen it, if not prevent it? Take for example the amount that fracking is a small, if you took all the water that you lose to fracking, I think I mentioned the statistic last week, you could power San Francisco, or you could give enough water to San Francisco the last 3 days. If you took all the water that gets spilled out from all the oil drilling, okay, you could power it for three, or you could provide them with water for 3 years. So, these types of things, I just feel like... there's ways that there's things that could have been done to understanding that droughts have happened in California in the past, were likely to happen again. I think that they A, could have prepared for it better in terms of riding it out, but B, could have taken stock of that and said, hey, if we, instead of just taking all of this groundwater, for example, and using it immediately on the crops and so on and so forth, what if we you know, built larger reservoirs, et cetera, even, you know, seawater, move seawater inland into large reservoirs and allow that to evaporate. And again, because, I mean, water is a pretty simple system. It evaporates out of lakes, reservoirs, whatever else, and then falls back down in rain. Now, right now, they're saying that the water that's evaporating out of California is basically headed north up into the Oregon, Washington area. You know, but I mean, I guess what I'm getting at is, you know, I don't think we need a cloud seeding type or weather modification type explanation for drought. I mean, there's, you know, droughts happen, first of all. And second of all, when you're mismanaging water resources in all of the ways that you just described, I think you're basically asking for this sort of thing. You know?
I mean, and isn't that what we're here to do? I mean, I think you raise a really good point, because we have to ask ourselves, okay, let's just say that there is a small, tiny amount of cloud seeding going on in weather modification, and then we dump on top of that what seems to me to be intentional, just neglect when it comes to the infrastructure that should have been put in place a long ass time ago, considering the weather in California and their history of rainfall in general. So, I mean, Could we also ask the question if maybe all of these things put together don't raise a larger question as to whether this is intentional or not in some way?
Well, and I think, you know, the question that I have in my mind is, you know, how much do we really need to worry about this? And I don't mean in the sense of, you know, if they're fucking with the weather, obviously we need to worry about it. Okay? And I absolutely, as I've said, I'm sure they are fucking with the weather, and I don't agree with that idea at all. I don't think they should be weaponizing it. I don't think that they should be fucking with nature, period. However, okay, when we compare this to other things that we've discussed on the show, and this is a very serious question, so we've discussed, you know, the 9/11 conspiracy, you know, we've discussed, you know, certainly the conspiracy that is capitalism, especially conservative capitalism, and the rush to make the rich richer and the screw the working man. You know, in contrast to those sorts of things, I'm wondering how worried do we need to be about weather modification?
It depends on how far you're willing to go in the assertions being made by some. You know, for example, one of the bigger assertions that this guy makes, Dane Wigington, is that the overall climate health of the planet is dire, okay? And that there are
a lot of people are saying that. I mean,
right. But I mean, he's I think going a step further than climate change, and certainly, I mean, again, this opens up another, you know, can of worms or whatever when you start talking about, you know, Al Gore's climate change and carbon credits, versus what someone like this guy is saying, right? It's kind of two different, both dire pictures, but two different ones. Okay, and you know, I guess, you know, again, to listen to him and to read the articles, it paints a very dire picture. And no, I'm not buying into it, or, you know, 100% saying, yeah, this is exactly what it is, right on. But I kind of go back to what I was saying about a couple other things in this show, and that's if 50% of what he says is true, then I think the picture is a lot worse than we even think or know right now. You know, he suggests, and this is actually, he brought it up from other people, you know, he was citing other sources, saying that the, you know, earthquake tsunami that triggered Fukushima was man-made. So, And again, as far as intent or what happened, was it a mistake? Was it purposely done? I don't know. But, you know, that kind of information is out there, and they have, again, they have readings and statistical information that are very anomalous to like, why did this create, you know, it just happened out of nowhere. Whatever happened to create the earthquake and all this was, like, very not normal, according to all, you know, the data that we have for how these, what's that?
Are you talking about CERN and the Hadron Collider?
No. The earthquake that, ultimately led to the tsunami that, off the coast of Japan, the earthquake that happened that led to the tsunami that led to Fukushima.
I apologize.
So, again, I guess to answer your question for me anyway, Adam, is it's how far do you want to go down that rabbit hole, right? And how much are you willing to...
But now,
again, my purpose for, the show and talking about it is I think that what we have been talking about through 15 episodes here are the psychopaths that run this planet, okay?
Right.
And to know that they have a pretty inexpensive means to... to drastically change, right, our world around us is a scary thought,
Don't they do that all the time? I mean, with or without weather modification, aren't they drastically changing the world around us all the time?
Sure, but, it's like you said, I can grow my own food. Well, Henry Kissinger said, control the food, control the people. And you know what? You can't grow the fruit if all of a sudden the frost is staying around until July, or it's coming in September.
You got to move further south.
It's how far do you want to go down that road? And all I'm saying is that. Is looking at what they can do with the psychopaths who can do it. I think there is cause. Because are there other causes for concern that we've talked about? Absolutely. And to throw this one onto the pile, in my opinion.
But I think the other causes for concern that we've talked about are again just a lot more concrete. All I'm saying is, we have to accept the fact that there are absolutely people out there who are conspiracy nuts. Okay.
Uh-huh.
I mean, we all know them.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. We've all met them. They exist.
Mm-hmm.
And every single piece of data that they come up with supports their conspiracy theories. You know what I mean? Now, is this what did you say it was? Dane Wiggins?
Wigginton. Yep.
Wigginton. Okay. Now, is he among them? I mean, I don't know. Again, I
yeah. See, I just don't get that feeling.
This stuff.
I mean, from everything that I see and read, and I feel like I have a pretty discerning, skeptical approach, you might get a guy, these crazy conspiracy theorists that put out a YouTube video, right? And the moon landing was fake, and it's an hour long, and they give you all their reasons, right? But that's it. You do not put together the type of website, information, data, research, everything that this guy has. He runs a weekly or a daily podcast himself. And again, the way it is documented, the way it is sourced, everything about it leads me to believe that it's, again, at least everything, I believe... What he is saying, he's giving his version of the truth. Okay,
so I believe he believes what he's saying.
I contrast that greatly to someone who makes an hour YouTube video on the fake moon landing. I can't compare the two.
But now here's what I think is a solid question. Okay, Now you said it, and I.
About 2 minutes left, fellas. So that's
right. You said it, and I said it as well. That, you know, we're not experts when it comes to this sort of thing. When it comes to the interpretation of the kind of data that he's presenting, okay, we're kind of deferring to him or to others to sort of piece that data together and create and turn it into a narrative. Okay. Now that being the case, okay, here's what I have to ask. How many other experts are agreeing with him?
I can get you a list for next week.
Okay. I mean, I don't even need a list. A number would be fine. If there's,
right. Well, that's what I'm kind
you
of
You know,
mean,
if there's five people, then that says something. If there's 5,000 people, you know, experts, then that says something else. I mean, it's
right, but, you know, yes and no.
People who are experts.
Yes and no, because, you know, and I know we're going to wrap it up in a minute, and I'm sure Bax is with me on this, though. You know, like, when I, you know, when we haven't talked about it much here on this show, but, you know, when you're talking about, like, ancient archaeology, right, and there's a lot of evidence by, you know, a relatively small number of archaeologists out there who are seemingly making discoveries and finds that go against a lot of the narrative of what we know as, you know, the human story. And that this evidence seems to get poo-pooed by the mainstream archaeologists.
You're right.
And that sort of thing. So it's, you know, again, it's...
But
I'm just saying, as far as like a number of people doesn't necessarily.
It doesn't, but there's a difference when you're talking about archaeological discoveries that you know don't exactly have a huge impact on the way we live our lives today, versus something that could be threatening the lives of all of us. I mean, if he's correct that this is a threat to every, you know, is a legitimate threat to everybody on the planet, or even just the United States, or anything like that. Then I would think that, you know, people are going to consider it a little bit more seriously, and B, again, anybody who is an expert that sees what he's seeing, the way he's seeing it, is definitely going to step forward. So, you know, again, I just think it's a little bit of apples and oranges to compare that to the things like, again, the new stuff being discovered about Egypt or what have you. Where that's not really a threat to anybody.
Yeah,
you know what I mean?
It's just case in point as far as, you know, obviously how many people are willing to come out and potentially put their career, job, position on the line to go against the, you know, the mainstream story. That's all
right,
I was trying to point
out. I just think when there's a threat to everybody involved, then the whole, put my career thing on the line becomes a much less of a consideration than it does when it's simply academic, like with archaeology or whatever.
Yeah, but that is a threat there.
Let me get in here before we end the show.
Yeah, which is a minute.
yeah.
Okay, so I will understand both of your points, and I concede to both of your points in a lot of ways. But I will say that, you know, we've done a good job of raising the question and saying, hey, you know, there are a lot of questions here. What's really going on? Something's going on. And, you know, we were headed towards a pretty large economic disaster, and not a lot of experts were out there throwing numbers out and saying, everybody be careful, the bubble's about to pop. There were some, but not a lot. And that was a pretty dangerous thing, and it happened.
You're right.
So,
you're right.
I mean,
and that is a good example. You're right.
And I will say this, you know, I'm down here on the Outer Banks, and the Wright brothers were flying their planes, which is kind of funny. We're talking about this in a way, I guess. And there's a museum here. And a couple months before they flew that first plane, one of the leading NASA guys came out and said, man will never be in the skies. It's for the birds. I'm paraphrasing. And then about a month later, they flew the plane. So I think, as long as people like us keep questioning, keep pushing the limits and saying, you know, there are other possibilities, I think we're on the right path, no matter which one of us is right.
I would agree with that, and I think that's actually a good way to cap it off for now.
Fantastic, and only 3 minutes over. Not bad, guys. All right, well, that'll do it for this week's episode of Front Row at the Freak Show. I am Crafty here with Atomizer and Bax. We're going to be signing off for now. And, one little interruption as far as the connection goes, so not bad. Did pretty good in that respect. Thank you, fellas. A good convo as always. Next week, we've got to get our caller count up here. We need you freaks to be calling in and joining this conversation, and so I don't have to listen to these two clowns for 2+ hours. Got to get a couple more in there. But anyway, fellas, I thank you, and we will do it again next week. Same time, same day, all right?
All right, thanks, guys.
All right.
Have a great night.
You too. Have a good night.
Good night.
Thanks for tuning in to Front Row at the Freak Show. See you next Monday, June 15th at 8:30, right here on frontrowatthefreakshow.com.